Okay, so we've got a 1080p sized document. I've zoomed out to about 25% because I want to see things on a large scale. The idea is we're gonna create a simple scene in the countryside with mountains and stuff and clouds. And we're gonna kind of like move. We're gonna have like a person or a vehicle driving to the right, and then the scene is moving at different speeds. So first, what we'll do here, we've got layer one. Let's call layer one dirt, I guess. This is gonna be the floor, the dirt, whatever we'll call that. So we'll call that first layer dirt. And then with the brush tool, I'm going to draw a simple kind of like line in the horizon, something like this. But I'm going to draw it further than the edge of my canvas, and I'm going to draw it in a way so that it's kind of a complete shape. I just want to draw like a big line, something like that, and fill that in with a color. So something like that. The idea is that I'm drawing some of it off of the edge because it makes sense. This is going to need to move over as the vehicle is driving, right? The background is going to move. So draw the dirt, something like that. We're going to select that shape and turn it into a symbol so we can animate it. So I would say one way to select everything is press Control A on the keyboard, or you can press or you can click on the little dot of that frame. So you want to select everything. You want to right-click it, and then we've got Convert to Symbol, or F8 on the keyboard. So you want to select that shape that you drew, right-click, Convert to Symbol. Let's call this MC Dirt, Movie Clip Dirt. Thank you. Thank you. The type is going to be movie clip. Just click OK. The point of this, if you recall from CIS 125, the first part of the class, is if you want to animate things and we need to convert them into symbols, movie clip symbol is often one of the best ways to go because you can do a lot of things with it. Move it, rotate it, scale it, etc. The name of it then doesn't matter, but I call it MC Dirt, movie clip dirt. I want it to be about 4 seconds long that this moves. So you see down on the timeline, we've got our frames and we've also got our seconds, 4 seconds. I want to take approximately 4 seconds for this dirt road to move across the screen. So at frame 96, click on frame 96 and then press F6 on the keyboard. That's the same as right-click, insert, keyframe. So you can right-click, insert keyframe, or press F6. So I've got a keyframe on frame one, I've got a keyframe on frame 96, and I want to move the dirt road to the left on frame 96. So just move it over somewhat like that. Not so far that it goes past the edge of the canvas. You'll break the illusion. You want it to go maybe that far. So on frame one, the movie clip is towards the right over here. And then on frame 96, it's on the left. So I want to animate that because right now it just jumps quickly from the right side to the left side. I want to animate it in between. So between both of the keyframes, you want to right-click and select Create Motion Tween. Actually, let's do a classic tween. Let's back that up. Undo that. We'll do classic tween. So then now if you press play down at the bottom here, or you press enter, you see that the dirt moves over. Let's pause there. Do you see that? Is your dirt moving like that? Anyone need a little help? Okay, well, that doesn't look like a real movement of anything meaningful. So in order for it to have context, we're going to have a vehicle. Let's lock the dirt layer. Let's create a new layer and call it car. And then just take a moment to draw a little car on that new layer. So I'm going to draw a car somewhere over here. Really weird looking car. So I've drawn a car over here. You don't have to get too fancy with it, but what I'm going to do is I will kind of fill in some basic color so that it doesn't look transparent. It's going to be maybe a hot rod. Okay, so the point of putting the car is then when I go up to control test movie, control test, or control enter, and I see the actual movie, control enter, I see that the background is moving, the car is moving along the road as well, not very convincingly, because obviously a real car, maybe the wheels are turning, maybe it's kind of bouncing up and down on the road. Those are all of the extra aspects of animation to make it even more realistic. But at this point, what I'm trying to do is build a scene. Okay, we've got this dirt, road. We're then going to start to add the other aspects in just a moment. But let's set ourselves up like this. Dirt road, car, then we'll add mountains and stuff in just a moment. So let's see what we've got at this point.
Thank you.
At the moment, it's very basic in terms of that if I play it, okay, well, the vehicle seems to be moving across a desolate landscape, so let's add a few more features like mountains and clouds and the sun and stuff. So I've got a layer with the car, I've got a layer with dirt. Let's make a new layer and call it mountain. A new mountain layer. Now, make sure you're locking the layers that you're not working on, and make sure you've selected the layer that you are working on. It's obvious which I'm working on because it's highlighted. I'm on the mountain layer, so brand new layer, mountain. And I want to draw a mountain, but the mountain is further than everything here, so the order of my layers should be that the mountain is at the bottom. So move that mountain layer to the bottom, because it's going to be behind everything. So remember, layers, basically from top to bottom, is what's closer to you, in a sense, the camera. So the mountain is the further thing away, and I'm going to draw a mountain. So brush tool, mountain, and something like this, maybe. And I'm going to do the same thing in that in order for me to fill in the color, it's got to be a complete shape. So I'm just going to go outside of the shape of the mountain to close it. Let me hide my dirt for a moment. The point is here, I want to have this shape closed or else I can't fill in color. And I'm making it a little bit bigger. This time, not as big as the dirt. I didn't, on the width of it, I didn't make it as long as the dirt. I made it slightly less length than the dirt. The point of this is, the way parallax works is, all of this is happening in 4 seconds. And things will appear to move faster when they have to travel more distance, and things will look slower when they travel less distance. So, it makes sense that when you're close to the camera here, this dirt road is gonna pass fast. Because look at how much has to move in 4 seconds. All of this has to move over in 4 seconds. This mountain, I'm going to have it only moving a little bit over in 4 seconds. So that it looks like it's going to look like the mountains are moving very slowly. And that's what happens in real life. Have you ever driven down, you know, the highway in an area where you can see off in the distance? The things near you move really fast because you're driving 65 or 75 or 95 miles an hour. I won't tell on you, but you know, follow the speed limit, please. And you're going 65 miles an hour, and things nearby you zoom by because they're close. If you see a mountain a mile away, 10 miles away, 50 miles away, it moves so slow because it's so far away. And then the clouds don't seem to move at all because, again, they're 100 miles away. And the sun doesn't seem to move at all either because it's even further away. So the trick with this parallax scrolling is you move things at different speeds by how much they go across the screen. With the mountain here, it's going to be the same idea that I'm going to draw this mountain shape. I'm going to fill it in with some color. Let me see. Maybe what's a good color here? Mountain. What's a good mountain color? I don't know, orange for the moment. And I'm going to fill that color in. Well, that object in its own layer needs to move. So I need to turn that mountain shape into a symbol. So I'm going to lock my other layers, I'm going to select my mountain object. I really think the easiest way to select everything in a layer is you just click the dot of that layer that selects everything. Then you want to either right click or F8 to create a convert to a symbol. We'll call that MC Mountain, Movie Clip Mountain. So the dirt road is a layer, and it has a frame, it has a symbol. The mountain is its own layer, it's a symbol as well. On frame one, the mountain is toward the right of the scene. On frame 96, I will press F6 or right click insert frame, or keyframe, insert keyframe. And then I will move the mountain a little bit to the left, and I'm using the keyboard instead of my mouse, which might move it might move up and down, it might wobble. I'm going to use the arrow keys, shift arrow keys, to move it a little bit over to the left. So frame one, the mountain is right here. Frame 96, the mountain's moved over a little bit. And in between those two keyframes, you right-click, create classic tween. And now when you play it, things are moving at a slightly different speed. When you do Control Enter, it'll show you the speed of the road, the speed of the mountains. The mountains are moving not that far, so they seem a little slower in the same 4 seconds. The road, the dirt road's a little faster. So when you scrub the playhead here, you see that the dirt is moving at a certain speed, the mountain's at another speed. I'm going to add a clear blue sky, and then I'm going to add clouds. So we could change simply the canvas color. Right, you can change the color of your stage to blue, but I'm actually going to create a new layer called sky and make a shape that will be the color of the sky. And the point of that is, if I want to do fancy things in the sky, I'm stuck. If I do it as the stage, I can't animate the sky very easily. It's stuck on the stage. But if instead I make a layer called sky and I put it there, I can do different things, like maybe I can animate it with a gradient in that, like maybe the sun is going down and stuff. So I'm going to lock these layers and create a new layer called sky. Since the sky is also further, I'll put it at the bottom. And then I'm going to draw a shape to be the sky, just a simple square. Sky layer. I'm going to lock the sky layer. I'm not going to do much with it. I just need it there as a background. New layer, I'll call it clouds. So car is the topmost layer, which then sits on top of the dirt road, which is then ahead of the mountain. We're going to have clouds and then the sky behind it all. So I'm locking all of the layers I don't need to work with, and then I'll go to my clouds layer, draw some simple clouds. So I've got two clouds or different shapes of clouds, but they're all going to be the same symbol. As many clouds as I want to have, they're all going to move at the same speed. I don't want to get too fancy. If I put them in different, if I want different clouds to move at different speeds, sure. But I'm going to put all those clouds in one symbol. So both of these clouds that I drew, I'm going to select them both. Remember, you can do Control A and then F8. To turn that into a symbol, we'll call it MC Clouds. So in the clouds layer, the clouds are their own symbol. I will go to frame 96 and press F6 or right-click Insert Keyframe. And I'm going to move the clouds just a little bit over. Actually, this time I'll move it to the opposite side. I've been moving everything to the left. This time I'm going to move it to the right. The reason for that is, again, just to show the background moving in different speeds. I'm having the dirt and the mountains both move to the left to give the illusion that the car is moving to the right. Here, I'm going to move the clouds to the right also, not to the left like the rest of the landscape is moving. This is just like, I don't know, wind patterns up in the stratosphere moving the clouds in that direction. It doesn't have to line up with everything moves to the left because the car is moving to the right. I'm going the opposite here. And the point of that is that when I do right-click, create classic tween, my result here is when I Control-Enter, the result is that things are moving at different speeds. So you get this sense, you should get some sense of then depth, because the different speeds of everything. You see here the mountains are closer to us than the clouds, so you see that there's that perspective. This dirt over here is ahead of the mountains, moving faster with the car. Maybe a signpost in a moment that zooms by. Here's how it is so far. Very simple shapes and stuff, but conceptually we've got different layers animating at different speeds. Anyone need a little help at the moment? How's it coming along? We'll do one more thing with this parallax concept, then we'll go to the next concept. This is just the big idea is that you have different layers with different things moving at different speeds. We started with the dirt road as our main speed, and then everything else is a little slower. And the reason I'm saying it's slower, everything's taking the same 4 seconds, but things are faster when they have to travel further across the screen. You saw here, the dirt has to go from that far it is on the right all the way to the left. The mountains, I'm having them move very little. And then the clouds even less. Okay, well, the opposite. I want to move something to move really fast. Well, let's say I want a stop sign or a stoplight or one of those signs on the side of the road that says slow down. I want it to zoom by really fast. Well, that means in the same amount of time, 4 seconds, something has to move really far across the screen. So let's make a new layer, and we'll put it at the very top, actually. We'll call it street sign. Now, I would say on these, don't put any spaces on the names of your layers. This will be more important later when we do action script, which is when we program it for something to happen. These names as just single words is going to be better. I'm going to lock all of the layers, go back to frame 1 in my street sign layer. I'm going to draw a street sign. So maybe like a little stop sign. Let's see, I'm going to start it on the right. No, actually, I'm going to start it outside of the canvas. So the idea is it's going to be outside of the canvas. Okay, the trick here is it's going to be outside of the canvas. And as I said, when something needs to travel across the screen in the same amount of time, the further it has to travel, the faster it'll be. So actually, I need to move this even further out from the stage. Before I do that, I'm going to convert that into a symbol. So that street sign, I'm going to select it, convert to a symbol, we'll call it MC stop. I'm going to zoom out even more, and I'm going to move the stop sign way out here. I'm going to move it way out here. It's out further than the end of the road. It's way out here. On frame 96, I will insert keyframe and move it out over somewhere out here. So when I do the motion, when I do the classic tune, it's going to need to move all the way across from the right side all the way to the left side in the same 4 seconds. It will then basically move it really fast across the speed. If I started it right here and I moved it to right here, it doesn't have to travel very far, so it'll be slow. But if I move it way out here to way out here, it's going to have to move really fast to do it all in 4 seconds. The logic behind it. So on frame 1, I've got the stop sign way out there. On frame 96, I will press F6 to insert blank keyframe, or I'm sorry, to insert keyframe, and then move the stop sign all the way to the left, somewhere over here. So frame 1, it's all the way to the right. Frame 96 is all the way to the left, and in between, right-click, insert, create classic tween. Now when I see the result, he's drooling so fast, he zoomed by the stop sign without even seeing it. Okay, so the stop sign is on the topmost layer, so in the perspective of the movie, it is kind of like closer to us in the camera, and it has to travel so far of a distance in the same 4 seconds that it zooms by in the scene. We've got different layers for the different objects. That's often a really good way to do the animation, because you've got one concept on its own layer, with its own speed, and then you do this perspective. Here's the idea of the parallax scrolling. Okay, so let's say we're going to introduce a couple of concepts here. One is going to be, okay, this is the parallax scrolling. We're going to do also scenes and music. Let's do scenes first. Okay, with scenes, this project started like right here, like suddenly, okay, the car's driving. I want to have first like a little bit of text or like the name of the movie or something like that. I want to display something first and then I want to display something later. So this is where scenes are going to come in. Now if you notice on the top right corner here where you've got your zoom, you've got your different levels of zoom, and then the first icon is this edit scene. This little icon here is the classic clapper board in the movies. That's the thing where they go like, they hit it and they say action, you know, that little clapper thing. Right now it says we've got one scene, scene one. Well, let's go up to the window menu and we've got scene. We've got a little panel here where we can look at scenes. And a scene is basically, we look at our movie from this angle for a moment, and then we look at another angle, so to speak. So let's go to the window menu scene. We've currently got one scene. From this screen, from this little panel here, we've got the first icon, add a scene. So let's add a scene. We've got scene one, scene two. So scene one is where we've got the car action, and then another scene two. Let's rename this so you can simply double-click scene 1 and we'll call that car action. And scene 2, I'm going to call it title. I want some text to appear first, so that's the title. Then I want the car action to happen. Well, the order of these is backwards. I want to move, I want to drag title to be first. So I want to display some title of the movie first, then I want to display the car action. So just move those correctly like that. And now I get a brand new layers, a brand new scene. All of the stuff that was in the car action scene is still there, of course. But what will happen is all of the frames of the title scene will happen first, and then the car action. So what I want to do in the title is just write maybe the name of this little quick project here. We'll say, Going for a Drive. That's the name of this movie here. This movie is called Going for a Drive. You can get fancy, of course, use a font, draw it really nice, whatever. I'm just putting right here. This is the title of this project. In its own scene, the title scene, it's going to say, Going for a Drive. After we see this part, then it'll automatically play over to the next scene, Car Action, and then the car action scene will happen. So I'm gonna test it out. I'm going to go to my title scene right here. I'll press Control Enter and I'll enjoy what I did. Actually, it happens so fast, didn't it? Look at that. It's like subliminally flashing. Like secret message. Well, that's because this is where it shows that, again, in our minds, this is working exactly how I thought. But when we actually play it, that's not how I thought it was. In my mind, it's going to show this text for, I don't know, 5 seconds, and then the movie starts. But no, what we've got here on our title scene is this lasts for one frame, which is 1/24th of a second. I want the title to be displayed for 3 seconds, and then I want the car to be visible. Well, that means I need to have a frame from frame 1 all the way to frame 72, 3 seconds. So you can right-click Insert Frame on frame 72, or press F5. And now that's what we've got. For 3 seconds, display the title. Then it'll automatically go to my car action scene. Then it'll go back to the opening scene, the first scene, the title scene. Now I'll test it. Control Enter. There it is. It's displaying for 3 seconds. Then the movie starts. Loops back to the beginning. Well, what I want is after the main car scene, I want it then to display to be continued. So try that. So what we've already done so far, now you try it. Make a brand new scene, make it say to be continued after the main scene of the car. So practice that on your own. I'll do it in just a moment, but make it say to be continued after your main action in a new scene. So I've made a brand new scene, I've added my to be continued message, and I've had it display for 4 seconds, 3 seconds, 5 seconds, whatever you want, but obviously not simply one frame. Then that'll also zoom by, that'll also flash by if it's only 1/24th of a second. And now when I test my project, I've got my title. Going for a drive, I've got the drive happening, and then to be continued. Pauses for a moment, then it starts over. We'll cover, of course, looping with ActionScript, or stopping permanently, or pressing a button to restart, and all that cool stuff. But for the moment, it's now we're building together a movie. We're building together an idea, different scenes, different actions, and such. Any questions so far? Is it working? Anyone having a little trouble? Okay, so let me just confirm that's working for a moment. Then we'll add some music. Make this really amazing with some music. Fine, I'm ready now.
There you go.
All right, so let's say we want to add some music to our project. This is the part where I'm going to show you. Have you ever heard of this little website called YouTube.com? No.
Never heard of it.
All right, so it's this brand new website that came out 10 years ago, and on YouTube. There's a whole library of free music that we can use. So if you don't have a YouTube account, you'll be able to create one. Question?
Wait, can we use anything that's labeled as royalty free?
Yeah, basically royalty-free, copyright-free, stuff like that. So if you find anything like that, that'd be good. But I'll show us all one from YouTube. So if you've got a YouTube account, you can get into the library of music files here. If you don't have a YouTube account, you'll need to create one at some point, because there's a lot of great music that we can use here. So let me show you where you can get that. Okay, so I'm gonna go to YouTube. Go ahead and go to you can go to YouTube. If you have a YouTube account, you want to sign in. So I'm gonna sign in, and I'll show you that you have access to the YouTube sound library. So the thing about YouTube is that basically you can use it as a consumer or as a creator. You can go to YouTube and consume videos. I'm going to watch this video, I'm going to watch another, I'm going to consume videos. Question there, guys? Matt and Isaac, you guys have a question? No? Okay. So you can create content also on YouTube. They've got their whole creator studio. So when you've got a YouTube account, on the top right corner, it'll show you your information. You can go to My Channel. And then under My Channel, you have Creator Studio. You can also get to it directly up on the top right by going to Creator Studio. Now, the first time you go there, perhaps it might say, oh, you need to set it up. And you can set it up for free. But you want to go to the Creator Studio of My Channel, because then you have on the left side this little Create button. You see over here, you've got Create. Here in the Creator Studio, you have all of these features. One of them is Create. And it doesn't sound like it, but here's where you can get all this free music for your projects under the Create button in the Creator Studio. When I click Create, here I am, audio library, free music or sound effects. So let me turn my volume here. Okay, let's see here. Brooks Dream. This says it's in the genre R&B and soul, and it's funky. So if I press play. Okay, here's another one. They Might Not. This one is Ambient and Dark. Okay, well, there's thousands of songs here, and notice I can organize them by genre, mood, instrument, duration, and attribution. So if I go to genre, I want to hear something that's alternative and punk. I select that. And I want the mood to be happy. I can select that. And so notice it's then focusing down on those that are what I've selected here. So this one here is 3 minutes long, 2 minutes long. Let's see how this one sounds. Okay, here's another one here. So you're not going to find any real official music from any official bands. And again, I don't recommend you use any real music, especially if you're going to use this as a portfolio piece that one day you want to put out there to the world for a commercial purpose, or like for your portfolio to get hired or whatever, because the music is copyrighted. You say, well, I paid 99 cents for it, it's mine. No, you've only paid it 99 cents to listen to it. You haven't paid to actually use it in a project. That costs hundreds, if not thousands of dollars. So the YouTube audio library here has many, many, many songs that are similar, perhaps, to music that you're interested in that you can use completely for free. I will say, though, if you notice, some of these results, they have a little icon right here. You might not see it on all of them, but on here, one of them has it. Now, the ones that have that extra icon, What that says is, you're free to use this song in any of your videos, but you must include the following in your video description. So this says, if you want to use this song, you have to use this description if you upload it anywhere, especially to YouTube. Let's see how it sounds. Yeah, it's cool. I might want to use it, but I need to then use that attribution. The thing that I don't like is I'm going to forget. I'm making my project, I'm making it amazing, I'm stressing over it, and I'm going to forget to put that note when I upload it. Then that's a copyright violation. So what I would say is, whatever music you find here, make sure the only thing that really you want to set here is attribution not required. That way you don't have to worry about, did I give them credit? Did I put where did it come from? I don't care. If I put it on attribution not required, any song that I find will be safe for you to use the most complete way that you want. And yes, it's going to eliminate a few songs here and there, but I think it's much better than I don't have to bother with attributing it. So then when I go here to show me stuff in hip-hop with instrument in maybe drums, attribution not required, I get all of these. Ooh, that one's gonna sound great. So the way that we use this is you get your free YouTube account, you go to your Creator Studio on the top right corner, and then in the Create menu item on the left, you have the audio library. You have all of these sounds from, like, you know, 1 minute to 10 minutes or whatever. You can go to duration. You also have sound effects. If you go to sound effects, categories, you know, categories of horror, water, weather. Let's see what's under horror. Aggressive zombie snarls. Okay, how about all of these sound pretty horrible. Alien squawk echo. Okay. Female aggressive zombie. Female monster attacking. Okay, what else do we have here? Horror, science fiction. What's under science fiction? Foreboding resonance. Really slow, I guess. Okay, how about outer space? Okay, robot code. Okay, so with any of these, if I want to use them, there's a download button. So I'm going to grab one of these sounds, I'm going to put it into the network folder, the My Documents, or you can grab your own, and then we'll put it into our movie to add to it. So let me just find something here. Hip-hop, how did I do this? Hip-hop, instrument, drums. I think I saw one that I liked. Okay, I'm going to do that one. So there's the download button. I'm going to download that. I'll put it into the network folder. So if you'd like to get a copy of it, then we can put it into your sound, into your project. Into the 126 folder, I just put a sound in there called Tomb Raider. That's the one I just downloaded. So to use it into our projects, let's see, I'm going to copy this to my desktop. In my project, file import to library, I've got this sound file, and Adobe Animate can take most common formats of sound or video. But MP3, very common sound file, we can use that. So File, Import, Import to Library. And on the desktop, I copied that sound file, Tomb Raider. So now it's part of my project. The way music will work for us here is music will go in its own layer, and we have various synchronization settings. In the Canvas homework, I mentioned that I recommend to use the stream synchronization so that the sound synchronizes best with the visuals on screen. The default synchronization often doesn't work as best as you think, because I want this music to play at the exact moment that I see these visuals. Well, often they don't synchronize unless you use stream, like I'm about to show you here. So my idea is I want this music to play when the main car action is happening. So wherever you want the music to happen, on whatever scene, you want a layer for music. Okay, so in my car action layer, I'm going to create a new layer. In my car action scene, I'm going to create a new layer. And I usually like to put the music layer at the very bottom. Music. So on this layer, I want the music to happen there. When you select the frame in the properties of the frame, you've got here sound. There's no sound. I can select the music I've uploaded. I did File, Import to Library. So in my library, I've got a sound. I can attach this sound to this frame. And on the sync, the synchronization, I want it to stream. Because then when I see it here in the timeline, now I see that the music is synchronized with the action on screen. Like, it's very common, it's very popular, let's say, like, when, you know, the drum is happening in the music, and you hear the hit of the drum, you want that to happen on screen, something to happen to the beat of the drum. You're not going to be able to synchronize what's happening on screen with what's happening in the music unless you have your music layer set to sync stream. It goes out of sync when it's on anything else. When I test it, obviously that's all it plays, 4 seconds, because the main music, the main movie lasts only 4 seconds. There he is, strolling. So, no music at the beginning, then music during the movie. No music at the end there. What I see all the time is that people forget to change sync from event to stream. And let's see how it looks with event. See a difference? See a difference? Okay, that's enough of that. The default, the music overlaps itself. Now, it sounded great that the music was playing at the end credit and the title and all of that. Great, but when the movie starts over and it hits that frame again, it will just simply start again. It'll overlap because it says here, synchronize with the event. On the event that the music is on that first frame, play it again. Now, to show you here, let me remove it, because here's what people do all the time, and we'll see why it's wrong. People do that on their opening, scene. And then, okay, I'm going to put music on my opening scene. I'm going to forget to change it from event to stream. I'm going to play it. Everything looks amazing. Cool, my music's playing at the beginning. Well, you know where it's headed. Because once the movie loops again, it'll overlap itself. Sounds really cool, actually. But after the second time, that it loops, it'll be unintelligible. So I really recommend, and I put it in the Canvas notes, change your music to stream. Now that will then cause other things to happen where like, okay, well, if I'm only playing the music for 4 seconds here, I have to play it again on my next scene. Yes, but I think that's going to be a lot better than the music overlapping on top of itself over and over and over. So the idea would be that, okay, on this first scene, I've got this music playing for a few seconds, and then yeah, on my other scene, I do have to also then put it to have the music there also, but on stream. So car action, music, event, stream, sync stream, and then now it'll play at the beginning, and then here again, and then not here because I don't want music, and then it starts over, and it's correct, it's not overlapping. You could go in then and to further kind of synchronize things how you want. Once you've got the music on the layer, you could go to edit the music on that layer and then cut it and move the sound and fade it in and stuff like that. When it's on its own layer, it is editable somewhat with that icon there. So if I were to click on that icon, I get it here. Do I want to fade in, a fade out? Where does the music start? So if I want to cut out the beginning, I don't want that first beginning part, I can move this over to the edge. So dragging it from here over here, I'm going to start 4 seconds later. I can use this to say, I'm going to start on scene two, my car action scene. I'm going to start the music at 5 seconds, because I play the first 4 seconds on the first scene, then the next 5 seconds here. Let's see how that synchronizes. So that's a little touch of music. Music, like I said, is going to be one of the requirements of this assignment. The parallax scrolling background that we did here. The music. We're still going to cover camera movement and walk cycles on the next lecture. But we're going to have, again, a couple of lectures and some lab time for you to start working on this. This will be due on Wednesday the, what did I say, the 27th. We're coming into the lab time in just a moment. So this practice that we've done here, remember to save it. I'm going to save a copy of this also into the network folder in case you want to look at my copy of it, get inspiration or see how I did it. But we'll have some lab time now. If you want to take a break, take a break. We'll have lab time until 4. You have the storyboard to turn in by 4 o'clock before you leave. You can start working on this animation, which will be due on the 27th.